centuries. I mean, it was centuries, quite a few centuries, before anybody even talked about anything resembling numerical conception. And great theologians and mystics of the Middle Ages, like St. Thomas Aquinas and very famously St. Bernard of Clairvaux, opposed the idea. They couldn't quite understand how Mary could have been free from the first moment of her conception from all sin. And according to doctrine, as according to St. Paul, all people are lost the glory of God and are subject to the sin of Adam. So as you might know, it was the Franciscan theologian Duns Scotus who came up with the idea that the Church adopted, that, well, Mary was saved by preview of the merits of her Son. So working retrospectively, she was spared from original sin from the first moment of her conception. So it was a couple more centuries before Pope Clement made it a feast of the Church, and then, of course, as I think you probably know, Pope Pius IX, in 1854, declared it a doctrine. Now, how does this work? I mean, I don't mean the Immaculate Conception itself, but our understanding of it, how we come to it. I think the very fact that it evolved over such a long time in the understanding of the Church is a clue to how things do make progress, how things do develop in the Church, across the board. And I think it's very important to realize that our understanding of Scripture, our understanding of the great mysteries of the faith, do grow and change, not primarily through some intellectual gymnastics, acrobatics, but through an assimilation that is contemplative, that is lived, that is through prayer, through the very life of the Church. That's how the great fathers of the Church, the late fathers like St. John Damascene, came to realize these depths to Mary, not to mention the early doctrines of Mary as Mother of God in the 5th century, etc. So, as we see, it's by the lived experience of the Church, the experience of Mary herself, by our experience of Mary, the Church's experience of Mary in her own life and in her own prayer, that we came to a deep understanding that of the rightness of this. No argument is sufficient in itself. You can argue theology back and forth. But the Church attained, you know, with the tools of theology where it was helpful, attained a deeper understanding of who Mary was and just how full of light and beauty she was through an experience of Mary. Through the experience ripened over centuries, but in the life of the Church over many years, the deep contemplative experience of Mary is what was really behind the Church's conviction. Not arguments, but experience. And the experience was, and is, that Mary, as the Mother of God, as the one who was receiving Christ, the incarnate Word, into her very self, was filled with light. She saw so much a being of light from the very first instant. So suffused and surrounded by light that she was sinless. Any kind of sin, original sin, personal sin, none of them touched her. The Church experienced that light. And that's how she knew. Then you find, you know, the necessary theological arguments to make a case for it. But the conviction comes first from the lived experience. And that's true, as I say, across the board. Understanding of the Eucharist, or understanding of any of the mysteries of the faith. Understanding of Jesus himself. Understanding of moral issues as they evolve over time. Comes through the lived experience of the Church. So I think there's a really wonderful lesson there of how things grow and develop and deepen in the Church, not primarily through intellectual speculation, but rather through the lived experience of prayer and devotion on the part of the people of God. And then the Pope finally says, well, okay, so let's, you know, define it. Okay, that's the first part of what I want to say. The second is, obviously, you know, obviously Protestants have a problem with this, and Orthodox Christians, even though they have a marvelously deep understanding and devotion, you know, to Mary as full of light and giver of life and fountain of life, reject this for ecclesiastical political reasons, and for they don't accept the particular view of the way it's formulated according to St. Augustine's theology of original sin and all of that. Okay, so that's part of the issue, but what Catholics also have do things that look wrong here, or have a tendency to approach things in a wrong way. So this is the doctrine, and it's a beautiful one that's based on the Church's long experience. Others have missed out for various reasons. But let us not make the mistake of saying, oh, well, this is what makes me a Catholic. And it's a doctrine because the Pope said so. And as you see right up there on the halo of Mary, she herself confirmed that she was Jésus de l'Immaculée Conception at the time, 4 years after the dogma was proclaimed, as she appeared to Bernadette. This whole Church proclaims that, and that's all fine. But let's not put our emphasis there. The emphasis is not on authority. The emphasis should be, once again, on calling all people to a deeper prayer experience, a deeper personal contact with Mary, and that's what will persuade or convince or change people's minds. Not an appeal to authority, etc. That's going about it the whole wrong way. As I just tried to explain, authority just comes in at the end of the process and says, okay, let's make it official. But the real process, the life-giving process, is going on in the life of the Church, and that's the way we should view it. And finally, another tendency that we have as Catholics, which I think is wrong-headed, is that we tend to say, well, this is Mary's own special prerogative. So we have to look at it from a distance and adore it and admire it, well, not adore it, but honor it from a distance. And of course, it is Mary's special privilege. But don't forget that whatever applies to Mary applies to the Church. One of the prayers for today's feast says that the Church looks at Mary, it looks at her own destiny in Mary as in a pure mirror. That's what she's called to. So all the texts of Scripture then become luminous, such as we have today, Mary full of grace, which we see in the ceiling up there. But as the second reading says, all of us have been blessed with spiritual blessings in the heavenly places, and all of us have been predestined to share in these wonderful spiritual blessings as adopted children of God, as Mary is. So it's a reminder to us, precisely in our relationship with Mary, to ask for a greater experience of, a greater transformation in that light which enfolds her and comes from her Son, who is light from light. So our relationship to this mystery should be one of, how can I participate more deeply in this? How can I become a being and a child of light to mirror Mary's own call as the mother and the first member of the Church? How can I bring Christ to birth in this Christmas time in my own self? How can I come to birth as Christ, as another Christ, through the intercession of Mary? How can I become a greater sharer in this magnificent light which she radiates on the world from her Son? So all these mysteries of Mary should not be something we say, well, I honor Mary and I'm a good Catholic and I believe the Pope. Yeah, okay, okay, okay. But how are you actually sharing in the mystery? How is it transforming your own life as it has been transforming the life of the Church throughout these 2,000 years? So it's an invitation to admire, but an invitation to participate. The same thing with Christ in the Eucharist. Yes, we can adore the Eucharist and the tabernacle, but it's above all to transform us into children of light, as Christ himself is light from light. It's always about our sharing in the mystery, not about our gazing at it from a distance. So once we begin to experience this, the beauty of Christ, the beauty of Mary, well, then we can be radiant witnesses to what it's really trying to say, what it's all about. And not just insist on, well, this is what I'm supposed to believe, and the Pope said so, etc. No, but what are you experiencing of it? You should know in your gut that this is the way things are, that this is the truth, that this is the beauty of our faith and of our life in Christ. So let's delve deep into the mystery here in our own experience, and not scratch our heads about theology or try to affirm it because somebody told us we're supposed to, but rather know it from within. That's what we should be doing with all the mysteries of our faith, And that's how exactly the mysteries of the faith evolved in the life of the church over the centuries. And